Good day. I'm Norman Wildberger. Last time we introduced the idea of integral polynumbers, which are polynumbers with integer coefficients. Now it's time for us to look at arithmetic with these objects. It's a very nice arena, very similar and parallel to arithmetic with ordinary integers. So let's just introduce the basic ideas with some examples. Here's how we add two integral polynumbers, just the way we add ordinary polynumbers. Each entry or coefficient is done separately. Here's how we multiply two of them, exactly the same rule. 2 times 4 gives us the 8. The minus 10 comes about from 2 times 1 plus minus 3 times 4. The minus 8 is 2 times minus 2 plus minus 3 times 1 plus 0 times 4. And the 6 is minus 3 times minus 2. We can multiply an integral polynumber by a scalar or a number. So for example, minus 1 times 5 minus 3 is minus 5, 3. And now one new operation that we can do, that we couldn't really do before, at least not consistently, is we can subtract one polynumber from another. So 4 minus 7, 1 minus 2, 5 is 2 minus 12, 1. And I remind you that you're allowed to add zeros to any polynumber at the bottom, and the polynumber does not change. All right, so we now have three operations that we can do with these integral polynumbers. We can add, we can multiply, and we can subtract. And they obey the standard laws that we're pretty familiar with ordinary polynumbers, and essentially the same laws that hold for ordinary integers. Now, I'm not going to go through all those laws and derive them again separately and state them. It's a good exercise for you to do. It's probably a lovely project for, say, a master's student to write this all down very concretely and clearly. So the main laws of arithmetic for integers hold also for our integral polynumbers, and here's our symbol for this type of mathematical object. Here's a nice little exercise that if the two polynumbers P and Q have the property that their product is the zero polynumber, then either P is the zero polynumber or Q is the zero polynumber. All right, so to get you thinking about arithmetic in this context, let's look at some simple and rather elegant little computations that perhaps are suggestive of other things for you, and maybe you can extend them in various directions and play around. If we take the polynumber 1, 1, and we square it, we get 1, 2, 1. And in standard alpha form, that's this expression here, that 1 plus alpha squared is 1 plus 2 alpha plus alpha squared. Slight variant, 1 minus 1, if we square that, we get 1 minus 2, 1, which corresponds to this little expression in alphas. Here we have 1, 1 times 1 minus 1 gives us 1, 0 minus 1. That corresponds to 1 plus alpha times 1 minus alpha equals 1 minus alpha squared. Here we have 1, 1 cubed this time, giving us 1, 3, 3, 1. And that's just the binomial theorem, a special case of it. 1 plus alpha cubed is 1 plus 3 alpha squared plus alpha cubed. And if we make a small change to a 1 and a minus 1 before we cube, then we get 1 minus 3, 3 minus 1, that expression there. Here's a nice, rather important kind of identity that we're going to be using later on quite a lot. 1 minus 1 times 1, 1, 1. Well, let me remind you of a way of computing this, which is instructive. So one way of doing that is to think of it as first multiplying by this 1, so you're just recopying this one over here. And then when we multiply by minus 1, the effect is to have a minus sign and shift everything down 1. So the difference between these two gives us 1, 0, 0, minus 1. And here's the corresponding identity, which is essentially kind of the formula for the geometric series. And a slight variant, when we have 1, 1 over here, times 1 minus 1, 1. Then we get 1, 0, 0, 1, corresponding to this identity here. 1 plus alpha times 1 minus alpha plus alpha squared equals 1 plus alpha cubed. So I hope you keep these identities in mind. Now here are some basic examples of easy arithmetic with integral polynumbers. And many of these will have generalizations that you can play around with and try to find them. 1, 1 times 1, 1, 1 is 1, 2, 2, 1. If we lengthen this one by one, then the string of twos also lengthens. Here are two trinomials multiplied together. 1, 1, 1 times 1, 1, 1 gives us 1, 2, 3, 2, 1. This one we've seen already before. Here's a slight variant on this one. 1 minus 1, 1 times 1 minus 1, 1 gives us 1 minus 2, 3 minus 2, 1. And 1, 1, 1 cubed is 1, 3, 6, 7, 6, 1. Triangular numbers are almost starting to appear there. Here's a pleasant little identity. This one here is essentially Pythagorean triple type of identity, and it's a manifestation in poly number form. Now let's have a little think about this one here. This is kind of interesting that up till now, when we've been thinking about identities like this, we think of an equation like this as representing a whole family of true statements, one for every alpha. So this potentially infinite family of identities is all captured by this one single equation, which doesn't have any variables in it, just some integers with our notation. That's something that to keep in mind for the future, that we can capture something that's seemingly infinite by something else, a little bit more complicated, which is completely finite. What a great idea that's going to be. All right, so to go a little bit more in this direction, next time we're going to talk about an important link between integral polynumbers and ordinary numbers, given by evaluation. And that's going to lead us to the factor theorem of Descartes. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.